This video will demonstrate the extended retrosigmoid craniotomy for resection of a large cystic vestibular schwannoma. The patient was in her late 70s. She presented with bilateral hearing loss, frequent headaches, blurred vision, difficulty with balance, gait, and ambulation. On exam, she had a hearing deficit and gait imbalance. Her MR images show this large cystic vestibular schwannoma that extends from the internal auditory canal and fills the cerebellopontine cistern with indentation of the brainstem. It measures nearly 3 centimeters in diameter. A retrosigmoid craniotomy was selected for the approach, given that the tumor did not extend deeply into the internal auditory canal. Patient position, skin incision, and craniotomy are all shown in these illustrations. Strategy consisted of the extended retrosigmoid craniotomy, CSF release from the cisterna magna, dissection into the cerebellopontine angle cistern, identification of the lower cranial nerves, choroid plexus, and the 7th and 8th nerve complex, central tumor debulking, tumor dissection from the cerebellum and brainstem, drilling of the internal auditory meatus, dissection of the distal facial nerve within the internal auditory canal, and the final piecemeal tumor resection. Here's the overview of the exposure. The top of the head is to the left, the feet are to the right, and the sigmoid sinus is at the top of the screen. After releasing CSF from the cisterna magna, the tumor capsule was probed to ensure that the facial nerve was not adherent. Next, the tumor was entered and debulked. You can see that there are these cystic components that were entered to release fluid and decompress the mass. Now the capsule can be collapsed and the tumor can be peeled away from the lower cranial nerves, which are seen here. This is the 9th and 10th nerve on the undersurface of the tumor, and the tumor here is being pulled upwards away from this lower cranial nerve bundle. This is the upper pole of the tumor, and I'm stimulating the trigeminal nerve with no response. Additional mapping around the tumor confirmed that the facial nerve was nowhere within this region. Therefore, additional aggressive tumor debulking could be performed here. The tumor here is being cut into pieces, pulled away from the cerebellum, and removed piecemeal. Now you can see this interface between the tumor capsule and the brainstem. Brainstem has this clean white appearance, and the tumor is being lifted by my sucker. There was some adhesion of the anterior inferior cerebellar artery to the capsule, and this artery is stripped free. The course of that artery was followed all the way to the front of the tumor. Now, additional tumor is debulked here with the CUSA and also with microscissors. Tumor is whittled into smaller pieces, which can be removed piecemeal. Here I'm following ICA more proximally to free it from the tumor. Now the 7th nerve has been identified and confirmed. With the 7th nerve in view now, the internal auditory meatus was drilled. This enabled the distal portion of the tumor to be visualized and peeled away from the vestibular nerves which were running in the canal. Here you can see that distal end of the tumor being pulled out of the canal and separated from the nerves. Now the tumor is being centrally debulked further. You can see the 6th nerve here running from the brainstem to Durello's canal along its cisternal segment. As these cranial nerves come into view and are freed from the tumor, additional piecemeal resection can be performed. Now again, I'm at the upper pole of the tumor and peeling that away. Now the tumor is being whittled down to just a thin rind of tumor on the facial nerve. The facial nerve was very adherent. You can see it here coursing over the top of the tumor. There was no good separation plane to free it, and therefore a small rind of tumor was left attached to the nerve. This is a view under the tentorium to expose the trochlear nerve. Here you can see the course of the 4th nerve as it runs forward towards the tentorium. Now the 6th nerve here is visualized as it leaves the pontomedullary sulcus and runs to Durello's canal. Here is the vertebro-basilar junction. You can see the two V4 segments joining at the basilar origin. And as I dissect between the V4 segments, the anterior spinal artery on the contralateral side comes into view. Here is the pica ipsilaterally with its origin from the V4 segment. And here now is our final overview showing the course of the seventh nerve from the brainstem to the internal auditory canal. This cystic vestibular schwannoma displaced the facial nerve superiorly, as shown in this illustration. When this happens, the nerve runs along the brainstem, then courses over the top of the tumor to reach the pons acousticus and the internal auditory canal. This illustration shows the relationship of the seventh nerve to the eighth nerve, and also how the cochlear nerve spins forward to reach the cochlea underneath the seventh nerve. The patient tolerated the procedure well. Her facial nerve function was preserved. She had postoperative ventriculomegaly, which required an external ventricular drain for several days. She was discharged home after a short hospital stay. Her postoperative MRI is shown here, and there is no evidence of residual other than what was left on the course of the facial nerve. In conclusion, cystic vestibular schwannomas are a rare subtype that exhibit clinical, radiological, and histopathological differences from the solid variant. Unique features of cystic schwannomas include larger size and atypical initial symptoms such as dysgeusia, vertigo, facial pain, and gait unsteadiness. Cystic schwannomas frequently exhibit atypical displacement of the facial nerve, emphasizing the importance of facial nerve dissection with stimulation to map the course of the nerve. Surgical outcomes for cystic schwannomas tend to be less favorable, with a higher incidence of subtotal tumor excision, worse facial nerve outcomes, and postoperative hydrocephalus. Thank you.